been a wonderful experience. So I hope you enjoy the show. Thank you.
She's the one the spinsters recommend. Just name the kind of man your sister wants and she'll snatch him up. Don't forget to bring your maiden aunt and she'll match him up. Call on Dolly. If your eldest daughter needs a friend, just name the kind of man your sister wants and she'll snatch him up. Don't forget to bring your maiden aunt and she'll watch him up. Call on
Dolly Levi. That's right, Mrs. Dolly Levi, born Gallagher. Social introductions. Ladies and gentlemen of excellent family, introduced under the most respectable conditions in an atmosphere of elegance and refinement. Object? Matrimony. Unfortunately, I won't be able to offer my usual lightning service today as I have a previous appointment in Yonkers, New York, arranging the second marriage of Mr. Horace Van de Gelder, the well-known half-a-millionaire. As my late husband Ephraim Levi used to say, that means he's got at least 60,000 cash. But I'll be sure to have you thrown across somebody's threshold by the end of this week. Might I also mention I'm available for financial consultation, instruction in the guitar and mandolin, short distance hauling, and varicose veins reduced.
Call on Dolly. She's the one the spinsters recommend. Just name the kind of man your sister wants and she'll snatch him up. Don't forget to bring your maiden aunts and she'll match him up.
Mr. Kemper, the artist!
Mrs. Levi, the train for Yonkers leaves in 5 minutes, and if we don't get there on time...
But we will, Mr. Kemper! And not only will Horace Van de Gelder give you permission to marry his niece, Ermengarde, but he will also dance at your wedding! And not alone, either, because I happen to be engaged in finding him a suitable second wife himself. What he really wants is someone steady to clean the house. As my late husband Ephraim Levi used to say, marriage is a bribe to make a housekeeper think she's a householder.
I know all about it, Mrs. Levi. Half New York says he's going to propose to Mrs. Irene Malloy this very afternoon.
Which is exactly why I'm on my way to Yonk this morning, Mr. Kemper, and can take on your case in well. What do you think of that? I have no money to pay my train fare with, only large bills, fives and sevens.
May have some change here somewhere. I only hope this isn't a wild goose chase, Mrs. Levi.
Speaking of poultry, I'm also available for fresh Jersey eggs, surgical corsets reboned, ears pierced, pierced ears replugged.
Mrs. Levi.
Just name the kind of man your sister wants and she'll snatch him up. Don't forget to bring your maiden aunts and she'll match him up. Call on Dolly.
Tell me, Mrs. Levi, what's in all this for you?
A living, Mr. Kemper. Some people paint, some sew. I meddle. I have always been a woman who arranges things for the pleasure and the profit it derives. I have always been a woman who arranges things like furniture, daffodils, and lives. When a man with a timid tongue meets a girl with a diffident air, why should the tortured creatures beat around the bush when heaven knows Mother Nature always needs a little push? So I put my hand in here, I put my hand in there. When a girl over 6'3" loves a man who comes up to her ear, surely it's obvious she'll never be seduced till some kind soul condescends to give her beau a little boost. So I put my hand in there, I put my hand in here. I have always been a woman who arranges things. It's my duty to assist the Lord above. I have always been a woman who arranges things like luncheon parties, poker games, and love. My aplomb at cosmetic art turned a frump to a trump lady fair. She had the countenance a little bit like Scrooge, but oh, today you would swear the Lord himself applied the rouge. So I put my hand in there, I twist a little, stir a little, him a little, her a little, shape a little, mold a little. Some poor chap gets sold a little when I use my fist a little. Some young bride gets kissed a little, pressure with the thumbs. Matrimony comes when I put my hand in there.
Mrs. Levi.
I know, Mr. Kemper, the Yonkers train is about to leave. Now you go buy our tickets, get a window seat, order lunch, and I'll meet you on board. Ephraim Levi. I'm going to get married again. I'm going to marry Horace Vandegelder for his money and send it out circulating among the people like rainwater, the way you taught me. And I want a sign from you. Sometime today that you approve. Oh, it won't be a marriage in the sense that we had one, but I will certainly make him happy. And Ephraim, I'm tired. Tired of living from hand to mouth, so I want that sign.
Mrs. Levi!
Sometime today. Now, don't you worry, Mr. Kemper. We'll make that train. We'll get to Yonkers. You'll marry Ermengarde. Just leave everything to me. For when my little pinky wiggles, some young maiden gets the giggles. Then I make my knuckles active. My, he says she's so attractive. Then I move my index digit, and they both begin to fidget. Then I clench my palm. The preacher reads a psalm when I put my hand in there.
Expected to play Yonkers, my Yonkers, with all that bellowing in my ear.
I can't help it, Uncle. I love Ambrose Kemper.
And I say you're too young to be in love with anybody. Here, take this.
I'm not too young. I'm 17, and in another year, I'll be an old maid.
Well, I forbid it. Dare to be an old maid, Ermengarde, and I'll cut you off without a cent. And don't cry in front of the store!
I can't help it! I'm unhappy!
Then by thunder, you'll go and weep for a while in New York, where it won't be noticed! Now go upstairs and start packing your trunk. And don't get any tears on the lock! It was just oil! Cornelius! Barnaby! You stamped Mr. Vandegelder? I did. Now I've got some news for you. Both. This afternoon I'm going to New York to march in the 14th Street Association Parade. And when I come back, you're going to have a mistress.
But I'm too young, Mr. Vandegelder.
Not yours, Helen Damnation. Mine. I mean, I'm getting married again. And in honor of that occasion, I've decided to promote you, Cornelius, to chief clerk.
And what am I now, Mr. Vandegelder?
You're an impertinent fool, that's what you are. And I'm promoting you from impertinent fool to chief clerk. Any more questions?
Yes!
What?
Does the chief clerk get an evening off once a week?
So that's the way you thank me for your promotion, is it? No, sir. You'll attend to the store as usual. Now get back to work!
Come on.
And don't forget to put the lid on the sheep dip! Evenings off. Marrying artists! Foolishness. 99% of people in this world are fools, and the rest of us are in great danger of contamination. Why, even I was once young, which was foolish, and got married, which was foolish, and was poor, which was more foolish than anything else. Then my wife died, which was foolish of her. I grew older, which was sensible of me, and became rich, friendless, and mean, which in Yonkers is about as far as you can go. Oh, I know what you're wondering now. Why a man of so much good sense should be planning something as foolish as getting married again. The answer's simple. This house without a woman would be an empty shell, and pretty dirty, too. It takes a woman, all powdered and pink, to joyously clean out the drain and the sink. And it takes an angel with long golden lashes and soft Dresden fingers for dumping the ashes.
Yes, it takes a woman, a dainty woman, a sweetheart, a mistress, a wife. Oh yes, it takes a woman, a fragile woman, to bring you the sweet things in life.
The frail young maiden who's constantly there for washing and blueing and shoeing the mare. And it takes a female for setting the table and weaning the Guernsey and cleaning the stable.
Yes, it takes a woman, a dainty woman, a sweetheart, a mistress, a wife. Oh yes, it takes a woman, a fragile woman, to bring you the sweet things in life.
And so she worked on till infinity. 3 cheers for femininity.
Rah, 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 F-E-M-I-T-Y.
F-E-M-I-T-Y? Get out of here! And in the winter, she'll shovel the ice and lovingly set out the traps for the mice. She's a joy and treasure for practically speaking. To whom can you turn when the plumbing is leaking?
To that dainty woman, that fragile woman, that sweetheart, that mistress, that wife. Oh yes, it takes a woman,
a husky woman,
to bring you the sweet things in life. Oh yes, it takes a woman, a dainty woman, a sweetheart, a mistress, a wife. Oh yes, it takes a woman, a fragile woman, to bring you the sweet things in life.
All right, out of here, all of you.
Come on, Bart.
Come on, let's go, scram. Get back to work.
Congratulations, congratulations, 1,000 congratulations.
What?
Congratulations, Mr. Van de Gelder. All of New York is buzzing with the news that you've practically proposed to Irene Malloy. The streets are lined with eligible young ladies stricken with grief. Oh, my congratulations and sympathy.
Sympathy?
Did I say that? A slip the tongue, that's all. No, I'm delighted with the happy news. After all, she wasn't easy to unload. By that I mean, you know what people said, although I, for one, never believed the rumors. No, I didn't.
Rumors? What rumors?
Nothing to get upset about, Mr. Van de Gelder. According to all known facts, her first husband passed on quite naturally. It's just that he went so sudden. A few spoons of chowder she made special for him and pfft. But it could happen to anyone. No, there's no truth in it. Just a few words of advice. Eat out.
Now hold on, Mrs. Levi. You mean to say that Mrs.
Malloy? I mean to say nothing, just friendly advice. Keep away from the chowder. By the way, she's ordered her wedding gown beautiful. You should see it. Black. As I said before, congratulations on your forthcoming nuptials, and may you rest in... I mean, may guardian angels watch over you both, particularly at dinner.
Now look here, Mrs. Levi, you introduced me to Mrs. Malloy, and rumors or not, I intend calling on her this afternoon, as arranged.
I guess there's nothing left for me to do than go back to New York and tell the other girl, the heiress, not to wait.
What did you say?
Nothing, a word, heiress.
Particulars, Mrs. Levi, I demand particulars. Her name.
Her name. Money. Ernestina Money.
What a lovely, lovely name.
Picture it, if you will. Hair as shiny as a newly minted dime. Eyes as big and as round as silver dollars. Skin as soft and as mossy as an old greenback.
I can feel her now.
Age 19, weight 102, waist 47.
Waist 47?
That's with the money belt. Now I can arrange for you to meet this Ernestina this very afternoon.
I ain't got time, Mrs. Levi. I gotta bring my niece Ermengarde to New York this afternoon until she forgets a certain Ambrose Kemper.
I can do that for you, Mr. Van de Gelder. I know how to handle such things.
Then I'm marching in the 14th Street Parade.
What an amazing coincidence! Guess who's riding in the main float? The spirit of 14th Street, Miss Money! Her mother was a cash, you know.
All right, Mrs. Levi. I'll meet Miss Money at the parade, but I still intend paying another call on Mrs. Malloy first.
Oh, very well. What races you make me run. I'll meet you outside of Mrs. Malloy's hat shop at 2:30 as usual.
One more thing, Mrs. Levi. Suppose I decide against Mrs. Malloy, and I don't like Miss Money neither.
Well then, I happen to have one more name on my list. A name I know as well as my own. But let's not get into that now. It'll come up in good time. But wait till you see Ernestina, Horace. A vision. A dream.
It takes a woman, all powdered and pink, to joyously clean out the drain in the sink. And it takes an angel with long golden lashes and soft Dresden fingers for dumping the ashes.
Yes, it takes a woman. Ya da 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 da. You know, Ephraim, I think I'll have this rendome over in blue wallpaper. Yes, in blue. Ermengarde, Ambrose, come up here. We've got plans to make.
Chief clerk. Promoted from chief clerk to chief clerk. And if I'm good, in another 10 years, I'll be promoted to chief clerk again. 33 years old, and I still don't get an evening free. When am I going to begin to live?
You can live on holidays, Cornelius.
Do you forget what we did last Christmas? All those canned tomatoes went bad and exploded. And you and I had to clean up the mess all afternoon. You call that living?
No!
Barnaby, you and I are going to New York.
You mean close the store?
Uh-huh.
Cornelius, we can't.
We'll have to. Some more rotten tomato cans are going to explode.
Holy cabooses! Cornelius, how do you know?
I'm going to light this candle on fire. That's how I know. They'll make such a smell that customers won't be able to come into the store for 24 hours. That'll give us an evening off. We're going to New York, Barnaby. We're gonna live. We're gonna be in danger. We're gonna be arrested!
Holy cabooses!
And one more thing. We're not coming back to Yonkers until we've each kissed a girl.
You can't do that, Cornelius. You don't know any girls.
I'm 33 years old. I've gotta begin sometime.
I'm only 17, Cornelius. It isn't so urgent for me.
New York, Barnaby. Elevated trains, the lights of Broadway. The stuffed whale at Barnum's Museum.
A stuffed whale?
A stuffed whale. What do you say, Barnaby?
Yes, Cornelius, yes!
Now the first thing to do is make you financially independent. I know, I'll find you a job. Can you dance?
I'm an artist, Mrs. Levi. I paint.
Well then, my card.
Mrs. Dolly Levi, painters taught how to dance.
Now there's a man, Rudolph Reisenweber at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant on 14th Street. I'll give you a note for him and we'll see if he can have you entered in the polka contest tonight. The prize is a week's engagement and a solid gold cup. Oh, the cups we won, Ephraim and me.
Hold on, Mrs. Levi. No fiancé of mine is gonna set foot in a cafe.
No!
And I don't mind saying that I'm surprised that you have acquaintances in a place like that.
Not acquaintances, Mr. Kemper. Friends. Dear friends from days gone by. My late husband Ephraim Levi believed in life in any place you can find it. Cafes, ballrooms, yes, even theaters. Why, even when times were bad, every night down the stairs at the Harmonia Gardens we came like clockwork, Ephraim and me.
Well, it's all very well to come down like clockwork, Mrs. Levi, but you're asking Ermengarde to work there.
No!
It's the only way to show Horace Van de Gelder we mean business. Now, you go to the Harmonia Gardens restaurant and tell them Mrs. Levi sent you, and incidentally tell Rudolph that Dolly's coming back and I want a table for two and a chicken at 8 o'clock tonight.
The bottom row looks all right, Cornelius. Now hold the candle under the ones on top. Not too close. They're swelled up like they're ready to burst. Holy cabooses! Cornelius, I can smell it up here!
Let's get dressed, Barnaby. We're going to New York! Out there, there's a world outside of Yonkers. Way out there, beyond this hick town, Barnaby. There's a slick town, Barnaby. Out there, full of shine, full of sparkle. Close your eyes and see it glisten, Barnaby. Listen, Barnaby. Put on your Sunday clothes, there's lots of world out there. Get out the brilliantine and dine cigars. We're gonna find adventure in the evening air. Girls in white in a perfume night, where the lights are bright as the stars. Put on your Sunday clothes, we're gonna ride through town in one of those new horse-drawn open cars. We'll see the shows at Delmonico's, and we'll close the town in a whirl, and we won't come home until we've kissed a girl.
Put on your Sunday clothes when you feel down and out. Strut down the street and have your picture took. Just like a dream, your spirits seem to turn about. That Sunday shine is a certain sign that you feel as fine as you look.
Beneath your parasol, the world is all a smile that makes you feel brand new down to your toes. Get out your feathers, your pats and leathers, your beads and buckles and balls, for there's no blue Monday.
Barnaby, we're going to New York. Elevated trains, the lights of Broadway.
Holy cabooses.
The stuffed whale at Barnum's Museum.
Wow.
Come on.
Put on your Sunday clothes when you feel down and out. Go down the street and have your picture took. Just like a dream, your spirit seems to turn about. That Sunday shine is a certain sign that you feel as fine as you look. Beneath your parasol, the world is all a smile that makes you feel brand new down to your toes. Get out your feathers, your hats and leathers, your beads and buckles and bows, for there's no blue Monday in your Sunday clothes. Beneath your boiler brim, the world's a simple song. A lovely lilt that makes you tilt your nose. Get out your slickers, your flannel knickers, your red suspenders and hose. For there's a blue Monday in your Sunday clothes.
Farmer's our sibling, don't cry on the valises. We haven't missed the train yet, thank the Lord. Lovely, you're grooving. Now look at all 11 pieces. We're 7 minutes late. All aboard!
All aboard! All aboard! All aboard! Put on your Sunday clothes. There's lots of world out there. Put on your silk cravat and patted shoes. For I can feel adventure in the
to a smoky spot, where the girls are hot as a field.
Put on your high silk hat and at the turn of golf, we'll wear a handmade graceway button glove. We'll join the actors and Tony Bastards and this I'm positive, and we won't come home
I tell you. What marriage? Oh, I thought you knew! The marriage Mrs. Levi's arranging between Mr. Horace Vandergelder, the well-known Yonkers half-a-millionaire, and my employer and friend, Mrs. Irene Malloy. Although, if you ask me, he'd never take the place of her late husband, Mr. Peter Malloy. May he rest in peace wherever he is. I'm not sure. He was a caution, you know. Oh, it's all too much, what with the husbands and new marriages and on top of everything else. Miss Mortimer returning this hat for a third time. Same old story. She wants cherries and feathers. Cherries and feathers to catch a beau, I suppose. Although, if you ask me, she'd be better with a nice heavy veil. I told her ribbons down our backs is what we'll be wearing this summer if we want to catch a gentleman's eye. But she'd have none of it. Cherries and feathers she wants, today of all days, when that poor, dear, sweet Mrs. Malloy has enough on her mind, what with...
With what? Ah!
With the door! It's stuck!
It's stuck! Then push!
I was saying, I can bite out my tongue for the things I've said and the things I'm going to say, but as long as I've gotten this far, I might as well go all the way. Mrs. Malloy, why?
Say it, Minnie, why have I decided to marry Horace Vandergelder?
Oh, Mrs. Malloy, I didn't ask you that. I'd rather die on the rack than ask you such a personal question. But as long as you did bring it up.
I'm marrying Horace Vandergelder for one reason, and one reason alone, Minnie. To get out of the millinery business. I hate hats!
Oh, Mrs. Malloy!
And I can no longer stand being suspected of being a wicked woman with nothing to show for it.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy!
Don't protest, Minnie. All milliners are suspected of being wicked women. It's why I can't go into restaurants or balls or theaters. Why, that's all the proof they need. Take my word for it, Minnie. Either I marry Horace Vandergelder, or I break out of this place like a fire engine. Not Miss Mortimer again.
Miss Mortimer, I'll take care of it.
No, Minnie, leave it be. You can make another hat for Mrs. Mortimer if you'd like. I'm wearing this one myself.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy, you can't! You're a widow, and that hat? Well, it's provocative, that's what.
It is, Minnie? Well, who knows who may walk into the store today and provocative. Maybe just what I'd like to be.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy!
I'll be wearing ribbons down my back this summer, blue and green, and streaming in the yellow sky. So if someone special comes my way this summer, he might notice me passing by. And so I'll try to make it easier to find me in the stillness of July, because a breeze might stir a rainbow up behind me that might happen to catch a gentleman's eye.
and he might smile and take me by the hand this summer, making me recall loving love can be. And so I will proudly wear ribbons down my back, shining in my hair. Then he might notice me.
Vandergelder?
No, Minnie, I don't. Peter Malloy, God rest him, was my share of love. And I'm not saying I was shortchanged. Once is enough for a woman, as long as it's true love. And it was that. Oh, look, Minnie, there's two men staring into the shop.
Men?
Why, I do believe they mean to come in here.
Men? In the shop? Oh, Mrs. Malloy, what shall we do?
Do? Why, flirt with them, of course. I'll give you the short one.
Mrs. Malloy! And you with all that talk about love!
Love enough I've had, Minnie. It's a bit of adventure I could do with now. We'll get them all heated up, and then we'll drop them cold. It'll be good practice for married life! Now, Minnie, you go into the workroom. I know some ways we can perk up our appearances. Besides, a bit of weight will only make them nervous and easier for us to...
If you say vampire, I'll scream!
Vampire! And so, I'll try to make it easier to find me in the stillness of July, because a breeze might stir a rainbow up behind me that might happen to catch a gentleman's eye. Oh, Minnie, we'll get an adventure out of this yet!
Don't get in there!
Get an adventure out of this yet, Barnaby? All day long, we wander around New York, and nothing happens. Then we come to the quietest street in the city, and suddenly...
Vandergelder!
Is he still out there? Go look!
He's sitting on that bench! Cornelius, are you sure this is an adventure?
Oh, you don't have to ask, Barnaby. When you're in one, you'll know it all right. How much money have you got left?
Not much, Cornelius. 40 cents for the train back, 30 cents for dinner, and 20 cents to see the whale. 90 cents, why?
When those women come back, we'll have to pretend to be... Customers, that's... Maybe the best thing to do is make them think we're rich. That's how we won't have to spend anything. We're two men about town looking for hats for ladies. Good afternoon, Mrs.
Malloy!
Here, Cornelius Ackle.
Here, Barnaby Tucker.
My pleasure, gentlemen. Now, what can I do for you?
Well, you see, we're two ladies about town looking for some hats to Malloy, and we wondered... We want a hat. For a lady. And everybody said to come to Mrs. Malloy's because she's so pretty. I mean, her hats are so pretty.
And so reasonable, Cornelius. As reasonable as under a dollar would still leave us enough to see the whale.
You've got to pay him no mind, ma'am. He's come all the way from Yonkers to see the stuffed whale, and he's all excited. Just keep an eye on that street, Barnaby. Maybe you'll see it pass by.
Is it big and black with those mean little red eyes?
Yes.
He's sitting on that bench!
Excuse me, but did you say Yonkers, Mr. Hackle?
Oh, yes, ma'am, Yonkers. And forgive me for saying this, but you should see Yonkers sometime. By that I mean Mr. Malloy would like to see Yonkers, too.
I'm a widow, Mr. Hackle.
You are?
Barnaby, she's a widow!
Oh, that's too bad. I'm sure Mr. Malloy would have enjoyed Yonkers, especially in that hat. On you, of course, not Mr. Malloy. May he rest in peace. You're Catholic, aren't you? Well, don't let that worry you. I'd be willing to change. Mrs. Malloy, if you ever happen to have a Sunday free in the near future, I'd be more than pleased to show you Yonkers from top to bottom.
Well, as a matter of fact, Mr. Hackle, I might be the sooner than you think.
Oh, really?
You see, I have a friend who lives in Yonkers.
Oh, do you?
Perhaps you know him?
Perhaps we do.
Although, it's usually foolish to ask in cases like this. It's Mr. Vandergelder.
Oh, Horace Vandergelder!
Oh, Vandergelder's hay and feed?
Why, yes, do you know him?
No.
Well, he's a very substantial man and well-liked, they tell me.
Oh, a very lovely man, Mrs. Malloy, very lovely. Has only one fault as far as I know. He's as hard as nails.
You know, now I wonder if your friend might
Cornelius,
like this one.
I think, look out!
Begging your pardon, Mrs. Malloy.
Gentlemen, what are you doing?
How about Mrs. Malloy? We'll explain later.
Come out of there this minute! Oh my...
We're as innocent as can be, Mrs. Malloy.
Well, really, Mr. Hackle? Mr. Tucker? Now I insist that you both come out of there or I'll be forced to... Mr. Vandergelder!
Mrs. Malloy, I don't suppose Mrs. Levi is here, is she? She was supposed to meet me on that bench 10 minutes ago. Well, she can just go looking for me if she comes. When I make an appointment, I like people to be on time. Here's a present for you. Chocolate-covered peanuts. Unshelled. That's the expensive kind. Did I just see you talking with two men?
Men! Men, Mr. Vandergelder, what would men be doing in a lady's hat shop? Well, why don't you come into my workroom? I am so anxious for you to see it.
I saw it last week.
So you did? Well, Mr. Vandergelder, what's new in the hay and feed business? I understand you have three friends, all hard as nails.
What on earth are you talking about?
Yonkers, Mr. Hackle. I hear it's a beautiful city.
And who's been telling you about Yonkers, may I ask?
Nobody. A friend.
What friend?
You see, he...
He?
A customer, Mr. Vandergelder. Someone quite well to do so. As a matter of fact, he was just in here buying hats for ladies. Perhaps you know him, although it's usually silly to ask in cases like this. It's, Mr. Cornelius Hackle.
Did you say Hackle?
Why, yes, do you know him?
He happens to be my head clerk, is all. Mrs. Malloy, I demand an explanation.
And I'm going to give it to you. Why shouldn't she know Cornelius Hackle? Everybody in New York knows Cornelius Hackle. He's here at the opera and all the fashionable homes. Why, he's at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant 3 times a week.
Impossible. He's only got $146.35, and I keep it in my own safe.
Oh, Mr. Vandergelder, you're killing me! He's one of the Hackles. They built the canal.
What canal?
The Erie! Both.
It ain't the same man.
Who took the horses out of Jenny Lynn's carriage and pulled her through the streets? Cornelius Hackle. Who dressed up as a waiter at the 14th Street Hotel and dropped an oyster down Mrs. Astor's... Oh, I can't say it. But it was Cornelius. He's the playboy of New York. Now, Irene, don't deny it. I can tell you were taken with him just like everybody else.
Dolly, I've only met him once in my life. Really,
excuse me.
Of course.
Minnie, hold your tongue!
There's a man in there!
Now look here, if there's a man in that closet...
No, Mr. Vandergelder, you can't! It's too dangerous!
No man that hides in ladies' closets can frighten me, Mrs. Levi. Stand aside.
No man, indeed. I'm sure you'd make short work out of any man with those muscles. I can see them now rippling back and forth under your coat. Ripple. Ripple. Ripple.
For the last time, Mrs. Levi, will you stand aside?
Stand indeed, Mr. Vandergelder. That's exactly what the court will want to know when you're accused of entering that closet without a search warrant.
What do you stand for if you don't stand for the law of this great land? I know what I stand for. I stand for motherhood, America, and a hot lunch for orphans. Take off your hat. Sir Betsy Ross's flag is passing. Do you see him on the hill at Gettysburg, 'neath that great triumphal arch? If you see him as he's trampling through the graves of wrath, stand up and march, march, march.
Has this not affected you, sir? I came here at 14 years of age as an immigrant girl from a land that oppressed my people. And I must echo here said by that great patriotic American.
Moses!
I stand for motherhood, America, and a hot lunch for orphans. Take off your hat, sir. There's a tear-stained eagle passing. Do you see him on the bridge at Waterloo? Need that great triumphal arch. If you hear him singing Dixie in the sugar cane, stand up and march, march, march. I stand for
Alamo, remember the Alamo. I regret that I would like to give for my country. In the words of Lincoln, one in my land and two in my sea. Yes, Dad, I dropped that cherry tree down. Oh, Stonewall Jackson, glory, glory, hallelujah. Stand up and march, march.
4 score and 7 years ago,
march, march. March, march, damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead. March, march, march. As you can see, Mr. Van de Gelder, there couldn't possibly be a man hiding in this closet.
It's you!
God bless you.
Mrs. Malloy.
All right, Mr. Vandergelder, there is a man in that cupboard.
Aha!
And another under this table.
What the devil?
And there also happens to be a very simple explanation, but for the present, good afternoon.
Good Lord, the whole room's crawling with men. I can hardly stand it. I take it I'll see you later this afternoon, Mr. Van de Gelder.
You most certainly will, Mrs. Levi, with a certain young lady on the main float at the end of the parade. Good day, Mrs. Malloy.
Mrs. Malloy, I can explain everything.
I do not wish to hear any explanations, Mr. Hackle. Just that you and Mr. Tucker do me the pleasure of leaving my shop at once, or I'll send for Officer Gogarty.
Well, if you ask me, Irene, calling an officer's letting them off too easy. The law courts, that's where they belong. I've been adding up the legal offenses these two have committed, and believe me, you have grounds for 2 writs, a non-compos mentis and a garnishee. Now, the first thing to do is try to show you've settled it amicably first. Have dinner with them.
Dinner?
Is that absolutely necessary, Dolly?
It's the way things are done in the law, Irene. Dinner first, garnishee after.
Well, if it must be, Mr. Hackle, Mr. Tucker, you may take Miss Faye and myself to dinner.
Delighted, Mrs. Malloy. And I speak for Barnaby, too. Now, I hear there's this very nice restaurant at the railway station.
Oh, no, Mr. Hackle. If the Harmonia Gardens is good enough for you and your fashionable friends, then it's good enough for us. I hear there's a lovely orchestra there, Minnie.
Oh, no, we couldn't do that, Mrs. Malloy. Now, don't misunderstand me. It isn't the money or anything. It's just,
It's the whale.
It's the whale. No, it isn't the whale, Barnaby. It's the dancing. You see, they have dancing in a place like that. Exhibitions, even contests. And I don't know how, and it would take me weeks, months, years to learn. Mrs. Dolly Levi, 33-year-old chief clerk, taught how to dance.
Now, it's very simple. You put one hand here and you put the other right.
It's no use. I have absolutely no sense of rhythm.
Absolutely no sense of rhythm is one of the primary requirements for learning by the Gallagher-Levi method. Just give me 5 minutes of your time, Mr. Hackle, and I'll have you dancing in the streets. Let's start with lesson 7, the waltz kick turn. It's very simple. Right foot touch, left foot touch, under, back, around, touch, back, through, around, behind, out, over. Release. Unfurl. That's wonderful. When I think of the lucky woman who will find heaven in your arms. Let's go back to lesson one. Put your hand on her waist and stand. With your right in her left hand.
Oh.
And one, two, three. One, two, three. One, two, three.
One, two, three. One, two, three. Look! I'm dancing! Woo! Oh! Well, I was.
Of course you were, Mr. Hackle. Take the someone whose arms you're in. Hold on to her tight and spin. And one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three.
Wow! I'm dancing!
Turn around and turn around, try floating in the air. Can't you be a little more aesthetic?
Don't you think my dancing has a polish and a flair?
The word I think I'd use is athletic!
For my heart is about to burst. My head is about to pop. And now that I'm dancing, who cares if I ever stop? Look at me, everyone! I, Cornelius Hackle Sport, am dancing!
You're next, Mr. Tucker! Glide and step and then step and glide.
And everyone, stand aside!
He's dancing!
You can learn to polka if you worked a week or so, or the tango filled with passion seething.
I might join the chorus of a castle garden show.
Whatever you do, for God's sakes, keep breathing!
For our heart is about to burst. Our head is about to pop. And now that we're dancing, who cares if we ever stop?
Come on, everyone, let's dance in the streets! If we ever stop,
one, two, three, one, two. And now that we're dancing, who cares if we ever stop?
Same. Pains in my back, aches in my side, and stabs in my back. I'm fine. My daughter Fanny got married, you know.
Did she?
A year ago, last September. It's been a long time since you've lived here, Mrs. Levi. Such a long, long time.
Ephraim, let me go. It's been long enough, Ephraim. Every night for all these years, I've let out the cat, I've locked the doors, I've made myself a little rum toddy, and before I went to bed, I said a prayer. Thanking God I was independent, that no one else's life was mixed up with mine. Then one night, an oak leaf fell out of my Bible. I placed it there when you asked me to marry you, Ephraim. A perfectly good oak leaf, but without life and without color, and I suddenly realized I was like that leaf. For years, I had not shed one tear, nor had been filled with the wonderful hope that something or other would turn out well. And so, I've decided to rejoin the human race. And Ephraim, I want you to give me away. before the parade passes by. I'm gonna get in step while there's still time left before the parade passes by.
Mrs. Levi, Cornelius is taking us down to see the 14th Street Parade. Everyone will be marching.
Why, Irene? You're crying.
Oh, Dolly, the world is full of wonderful things. Come with us, Dolly.
I will, Irene. I will. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna go and taste Saturday's high life before the parade passes by. I'm gonna get some life back into my life. I'm ready to move out in front. I've had enough of just passing by life with the rest of them, with the best of them. I can hold my head up high, for I've got a goal again, I've got a drive again. I'm gonna feel my heart coming alive again before the parade passes by. Look at that crowd up ahead. Listen and hear that brass harmony grow. Look at that crowd up ahead. Pardon me if my old spirit is showing. All of those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistle blows and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old baton before the parade passes by.
Passes by. Listen and hear that brass harmony growing. When the parade passes by, pardon me if my old spirit is showing. All of those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistles blow and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on.
She's beautiful. Everything you said and more. Don't move, Miss Money. I'm coming. I'm on my way. Hey, you, cut that out. That's my fiance. Stop, thief, pickpocket. Put that back, you. I paid for that girl and I want all the parts. Miss Money, what have they done to you? Mrs. Levi?
No.
What is the meaning of this?
Nothing to get upset about, Horace. A last-minute substitution. Miss Money had a sudden urgent business appointment at the Mint. They ran a little short, so she's helping them out. But she'll meet you at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant at 8 o'clock as usual.
That's the most expensive restaurant in the city.
And well, it should be. What food? And the fastest waiters in New York. By the way, I might be a little late, so Miss Money is going to meet you at the front of the restaurant. But wait till you see her, Horace, all in buttercup yellow in baby pink shoes, humming an old tune, Sweet Rosie O'Grady. Oh, you couldn't miss her if you tried.
I'll be there, Dolly, but only because I already paid for the introduction and I want to get my money's worth. But from this point on, you are hereby discharged as my marriage broker. Is that clear? From now on, Dolly Gallagher, you're just a woman like anyone else. Where are you taking me? What's happening? I have lawyers, you know. I'm half a millionaire.
Ephraim, he's as good as mine. I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old baton. Before the parade passes by.
Thank you.
We've just loved looking at the lights of 14th Street for these past 4 hours. But now perhaps you better call a hack or we won't make it to the Harmonia Gardens on time. Oh, look, there's one. Yoo-hoo.
Oh, no, we couldn't do that, Mrs. Malloy. Now, it isn't the money or anything. It's just that nowadays, really elegant people never take hacks.
Hacks is out.
They all go by streetcar.
Yeah, you know, J.P. Vanderbilt, Diamond Jim Morgan.
Well, then by all means, a streetcar.
Just think, I've been elegant all my life and never even knew it.
Of course, if you really want to be elegant.
We do.
You walk.
Yes, New York, it's really us, Barnaby and Cornelius.
All the guests of Mr. Hackle are feeling great and look spectacular.
What a knack
there is to that, acting like a born aristocrat. We've got elegance. If you ain't got elegance, you can never, ever carry it off.
All who are well-bred agree, Minnie Fay has pedigree.
Exercise your wildest whims tonight. We are out with Diamond Jims tonight.
Could they be misleading us?
Silver spoons were used for feeding us. We've got elegance. If you ain't got elegance, you can never, ever carry it off. Middle class, don't speak of it, savoir faire. We reek of it, some were born with rags and patches, but we use dollar bills for matches.
And Vanderbilt kowtows to us.
J.P. Morgan scrapes and bows to us.
We've got elegance, if you're born with elegance.
Have you noticed when I hold my cup, the saucer never moves?
And the way I keep my pinky up indubitably proves
that
we've got elegance, we've got built in elegance, and with elegance we'll carry it
all. We've got elegance. If you ain't got elegance, you can never, ever carry it off. We've got elegance.
We've got elegance. Look, Minnie, they're counting their money again. Isn't that just like the rich? Well, gentlemen, aren't you going to escort us in?
Oh, of course, Mrs. Malloy. Barnaby? Mrs. Malloy.
Yes, Mr. Hackle.
Mrs. Malloy, as we start inside, may I...
Yes, Mr. Hackle?
As we start inside, may I put my arm around your waist?
Yes, Mr. Hackle. Although I must warn you, a corset is a corset.
You heard Mrs. Levi. We have to show your uncle that we mean business. Now, can you weep a little faster? You're throwing me off step.
Wah!
Faster.
Wah!
That's it.
Und it is my order as head waiter of the Harmonia Gardens und your supreme commander that tonight of our nights our usual lightning service will be twice as lightning as ever. Or else... I trust you will find this table satisfactory, sir. The private dining rooms cost a bit more, but they do afford the best view of the entertainment.
$1.40, Cornelius. That's all that's left.
Are you sure? Count it again.
Cool. Prepare yourself for a big night, Minnie. We're out with two of New York's best-known sports.
I did make a mistake, Cornelius. It's only $1.35. I'll count it once more.
No, don't. We can't afford it.
I'm going to order everything on the menu. Winner!
I have told you before, sir, you will have to move. This table is reserved for Mrs. Levi und Party.
And who do you think I am? Only it's Horace Vandergelder und Party. She's in my und party. I ain't in hers.
Mr. Vandergelder, of course. It's just that Mrs. Levi mentioned nothing of you bringing
my personal physician. That's enough rouge, doctor.
But Mrs. Levi ordered the chicken for two.
Chicken? Chickens are dear.
Und Patimason, Soup de Jour, und Pomme Souffle.
Why didn't you tell me this was an Oriental establishment? We'll take two bowls of rice. Now get. Now, Miss Money, I understand you carry a respectable sum in your belt.
Yeah, $2. Only it's in my gotta.
Worry about our reputations, Cornelius, but Minnie and I don't care who sees us out tonight. Well, Minnie, what have you decided?
Oh, I can't order anything at these prices. I really couldn't.
Oh, great grindstones, what a sensible girl.
Waiter, get us four glasses of beer, a loaf of yesterday's bread, and some cheese.
Yesterday's bread? Oh, Cornelius, now I know how you manage to keep half New York in stitches all the time. Minnie, have you ever eaten pheasant?
Pheasant?
Say, why the closed curtains? Are you ashamed of something?
It's not that. I just felt a slight chill.
Oh, well, why didn't you say so? Here, I'll loan you this. Now let's order something to hold us till the rice comes. Waiter! Would you bring a roast suckling pig, chestnut and oyster stuffing, cheese fondue, and some lady fingers?
Now what do you have?
Hey,
sweet of you to worry about our digestion, Cornelius, but I'm sure the pheasants are fresh. We'll take four, please. And a nice red wine.
Wait a minute. No wine.
No wine!
Champagne!
Champagne!
It's once in a lifetime, Barnaby. Champagne and tutti-frutti ice cream. And Barnaby, give the band leader a nickel and tell him to play To a Wild Rose. We want music while we dine!
Say, this is a cafe, isn't it? Let's dance!
The Vandergelders don't dance, Miss Money. We're Presbyterian.
All right, I'll dance myself. Give him $2 for the band leader. And tell him to play something refined. I'm gonna do the Hoochie Coochie!
All right, Cornelius, I'll send for the band, but promise you won't order anything else.
You wait here, Miss Money. I'll tell them to play a nice waltz. Waiter! Waiter! Give this to the band leader and tell him to play a waltz.
Here's a nickel for the band leader. Would you tell him to play a...
Whoopee!
Miss Money!
And two more pheasants, please!
Cornelius!
My purse!
My wallet!
Here, you, that's my purse!
Excuse me, but that's my wallet. I know it's mine because there's nothing in it but a dollar, three dimes, five pennies, and a... Cornelius? Cornelius! Did he say two pheasants? Three, four... Pheasants for the house! And never mind if we don't get to see the whale. I'll buy my own!
Sir! Sir!
What's this? Shouting? How many times have I told you not to shout? This is a harmonia gardens restaurant, not one of those...
But sir! No.
The lady, she's here.
What? Are you sure, boy?
Like you told me. 8 o'clock on the nose. Up pulls a carriage and out steps a tall woman with the biggest handbag I ever saw.
It's she! Mrs. Levi, she's back! Yes, it's Dolly! Fritz, tell the band she just stepped out of a carriage!
Rudolph! It's true, no?
It's true, yeah! She just stepped out of a fighting old carriage, pulled by six black horses with gallant plumes!
Oh, wow. Rudolph, it's like old times again!
It is like old times!
Wait, sir!
Dolly. Oh, I know!
Sir! Rudy! She's here!
Hello, Harry, well, hello, Louie, it's so nice to be back home where I belong. You're looking swell, Manny. I can tell. Danny, you're still glowing, you're still growing, you're still going strong. I feel the room swaying for the bands playing one of my old favorite songs from way back when. So bridge that gap, fellas, find me an empty lap. Fellas, Dolly, you'll never go away again.
Hello, Dolly. Well, hello, Dolly. It's so nice to have you back where you belong. You're looking swell. Going strong, we feel the room swaying for the bands playing one of your old favorite songs from way back when. So
here's my hat, fellas. I'm staying where I'm at, fellas.
Promise you'll never go away again.
I went away from the lights of 14th Street and into my personal haze. But now that I'm back in the lights of 14th Street, tomorrow will be brighter than the good old days.
Those good old days. Hello, hello, Dolly. Well, hello, hello, there's Dolly.
Glad to see you, Hank. Let's thank my lucky star.
Your lucky star. Still get glances from us handsome men. So
golly gee, fellas, find me a vacant knee, fellas.
Dolly, you'll never go away again. You're still growing, you're still growing, you're still going strong.
In that getup, and you're a half hour late, and I demand an explanation of—
Ernestina.
Exactly.
Ernestina, whom I trusted.
She wanted to do the hoochie-coochie.
Well, she always was artistic. Rudolph, move our table down front. There's someone in the dance competition I particular want you to see. Now, don't let's say another word about it. I'm as shocked as you are. I can't eat a thing. What have you ordered?
What you wanted, a chicken. Now, see here, Mrs. Levi, about this hoochie-coochie girl.
Did you say a chicken? I don't think I could face a chicken. Not a chicken. Not today. Not after what's happened.
Good. Then cancel the chicken.
And bring a turkey.
What are you doing now?
Nothing. Just looking the place over. Getting acquainted with my surroundings.
That's the trouble with you, Dolly. Always wanting to know everything, always sticking your nose into other people's affairs. Anybody who married you would get as nervous as a cat.
What? What's that you're saying?
I said anybody who married you would—
Horace, stop right there. I'm surprised you would even say such a thing. Understand that once and for all, I have no intention of marrying you.
I didn't mean that.
I'm not some Irene Malloy who's had to be given turned by a few chocolate-covered peanuts. You go your way and I'll go mine. Why the idea of you even suggesting such a thing?
Mrs. Levi, you misunderstood me.
Well, I certainly do hope not. But if I had any intention of marrying you, it would be to a far more pleasure-loving man. But let's not say another word about it. Here's Rudolph with our food. I'll serve Mr. Van de Gelder Rudolph. Ooh, okay. Here's some white meat for you, and some dumplings, lighter than air they are, and some giblets, very good for you, very tender. No, as I said before, you go your way, and I'll go mine. Now start right in on the wine. I think it'll make you feel better at once. Now, since you brought the matter up, there's one more thing I'm going to say.
I didn't bring the matter up at all.
One more thing I ought to say before you forget all about it. It's true, I'm a woman who likes to know everything that's going on, who likes to manage things. But I wouldn't want to manage something as out of control as your household. You'll have to do that yourself, God helping you.
It's not out of control.
Very well, let's not speak of it anymore. Have some beets, Horace. They're good.
I don't like beets.
That's good. No, Horace, a complaining, quarrelsome, friendless soul like yours is no sort of companion for me. You salt your beets, and I'll salt mine.
Will you stop saying that?
I won't say another word.
Good.
Except this, Horace, at your age, you should enjoy hearing the honest truth.
My age? My age? You're always talking about my age.
Well, I don't know what your age is, but I do know that up in Yonkers, with bad food and a bad temper, you'll double it in 6 months. Have some more beets, Horace. They're good.
I don't like beets. I hate beets.
That's nice. Now dig right in. Yes, the pity of it is you could be a perfectly charming, witty, amiable man if you wanted to.
I don't want to be charming.
But you are. Look at you. Now sit back down and let's talk of something else. But there's one more thing I'm going to say.
I don't want to hear it. And you're wasting your time, Dolly Levi. I won't ask you to marry me.
Well, I guess that means you want me to ask you! Well, I'm sorry, Horace, I'm turning you down.
How can you turn me down when I haven't asked you anything?
It's no use arguing, I've made up your mind. Here, let me cut your wings.
I have a headache. I'm going back to my hotel.
No, you can't go now, the competition's about to begin.
Here's the money for the dinner. Here's $20. Wait a minute. There's nothing in here but a dollar, three dimes, five pennies, and a button. This isn't my purse. I've lost my purse.
Barnaby, that purse you found.
Impossible. I can't imagine you without your purse.
It's Vandergelder's. Cornelius, we better get out of here.
What am I gonna do? I've never been here before. They don't know me. Stop eating that turkey. I can't pay for it.
Horace, it's the latest thing, a polka. And there's one dancer I particularly want you to see. Rudolph, move our table down. Vandergelder can better see his graceful movements.
Wait a minute. That man! That dancer!
Isn't he wonderful? With talent like that, he's sure to win a solid gold cup!
It's been a perfectly wonderful evening, but I'm afraid we're gonna have to cut it a bit, excuse me, a bit short.
Minnie, look! A polka! Cornelius, I simply must have one dance!
But Vandergelder's right there!
We've got to go!
And we will go, but we'll dance our way out!
Cornelius Hackle.
Mr. Vandergelder.
Barnaby Tucker.
Mr. Vandergelder.
Armingard! What is the meaning of all of this? Get out of here!
Dolly Levi, this is your doing. What are you up to?
Mr. Vandergelder, I can explain everything.
I don't want to hear any explanations. You're fired!
Officer! Arrest that man!
What?
One right here!
We're fine? What are we gonna do?
Get your hands up!
I don't know how, but I'm just
gonna... Alright, come on, arrest them all!
I've told you Vandergelder was an evil man!
Quiet!
I've told you Vandergelder was an evil man.
Quiet!
That's better. Now, you are all charged disturbing the peace, assault and battery, inciting to riot, and many more equally serious violations of the law of this city. Is there anyone here to speak in your behalf? I say! Is there anyone here to speak in your behalf? Mrs. Dolly Levi, counselor at law.
Your Honor, the defense rests. No, there's no we need to call witness, Your Honor. I ask for freedom for my clients and a verdict of guilty of the only real culprit, Horace Vandegelder of Yonkers, New York.
Dolly.
The one person responsible for these grievous charges of willful destruction of private property.
A cut and torn, a wedge of roast, and a solid gold cup bent.
Cruelty to a poor, unfortunate minor. Would you mind repeating that, dear?
Begging your pardon, Mrs. Levi, but if it pleases the court, I have something to say.
I was just about to call on you, Mr. Hackle. Go right ahead.
Testify against me. You'll be discharged.
You've already done that, Mr. Vandegelder.
I'll do it again.
And you've done it again, too. But even if you hadn't, I'd still say what I have to say. Now, I don't know much about inciting a riot or disturbing the peace, but I do know that what happened to me today, which is the most important thing that can happen to a man, might have never have happened if I obeyed your orders and stayed in Yonkers, New York. Your Honor, I'm talking about none other than love.
What? You're trying to tell me that after 33 years you've fallen in love because you take one evening off?
Oh, no, Mr. Vandegelder. I didn't fall in love with Mrs. Irene Malloy of this city in just an evening. An hour. No, even... What's less than an hour?
A second.
Less than that.
A moment.
That's it. I'll go slowly so you can get it all down.
It only takes a moment for your eyes to meet, and then your heart knows in a moment you will never be alone again. I held her for an instant, but my arms felt sure and strong. It only takes a moment to be loved a whole life long.
Isn't the world full of wonderful things? There I sat cooped up in Yonkers for years and years, and so many wonderful people like Mrs. Malloy walking around New York, and I didn't know them at all. Well, I don't know whether you can all see from where you're sitting. For instance, the way her eyes, forehead, and cheek come together up here. Can you? I tell you right now, a fine woman is the greatest work of God on earth. You can talk all you like about Niagara Falls or the pyramids. They aren't in it at all. Well, of course, I've seen women before, but today I've talked to one equal to equal, and they're so different from men, and they're awfully mysterious too. I bet you can know a woman 100 years without even really being sure whether she liked you or not. Today, I've lost so many things. My job, my future, and everything that people think is important. But I don't care. Even if I have to dig ditches for the rest of my life, I'll be a ditch digger who once had a wonderful day.
Takes a moment, but his arms felt sure and strong. It only takes a moment.
And he held me for an instant, but his arms felt sure and strong. It only
all that love's about.
And we'll recall when time runs out
that it only took a moment to be loved.
Except Horace Vandergelder of Yonkers, New York. You're all dismissed. You're free, my children. Go, go, go.
You can see the prisoner now, Mrs. Levi.
Well, there's your life, Horace. Without niece, without clerks, without bride, and without your purse. I guess there's only one thing left for me to say.
If it's to ask me to marry you, Dolly Gallagher, never, not in a million years, under no circumstances will I ever marry you.
Oh, that wasn't it all, Horace. All I wanted to say to you was, goodbye.
What?
Goodbye.
Now, hold on, Dolly.
I failed, Horace. And when a woman fails, there's nothing left for her to say.
Wait.
But.
Hey.
Goodbye. 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 Don't try to stop me, Horace. Please. Wave your little hand and whisper so long, dearie. You ain't gonna see me anymore. But when you discover that your life is dreary, don't you come a-knocking at my door. Or I'll be all dolled up and singing that song that says, you dog, I told you so. So wave your little hand and whisper so long, dearie, dearie. Should have said so long ago. Oh, you treated me so rotten and rough. I've had enough of feeling low. So wave your little hand and whisper so long, dearie, dearie. Should have said so long ago. Oh, I can hear that choo-choo calling me on to a fancy new address. Oh, Lord, I hear that choo-choo calling me on board the Happiness Express. I'm gonna learn to dance and drink and smoke a cigarette. I've gone as far away from Yonkers as a girl can get. So, and on those cold winter nights, Horace, you can snuggle up to your cash register. It's a little lumpy, but it rings. Don't come a-knockin', I'll be all dolled up and singing that song that says, you dog, I told you so. So, Horace, you may find your life a sad old story when you see a dolly shuffled off to glory. Oh, I should have said so long, so long ago.
Thank you.
And I would marry you, Dolly Levi, if you were the last woman on Earth. Not if you asked me a million times. I didn't need you before, and I don't need you now. Dolly Levi, you go your way, and I'll go mine. Ugh! Dolly, Dolly, Dolly.
You stamped Mr. Van Degelder?
What? Oh, so it's you, is it? Come crawling back, have you?
No, Mr. Van Degelder. I just stopped by for my $146.35. You see, I've decided to go into business myself. And since the only business I know is hay and feed, I'm opening my own store.
And Cornelius has found the perfect location, Mr. Van Degelder. Right across the street from you.
So you think you can compete with Van Degelder's, do you? Well, just you try. Aha! Another one come crawling, is it? What do you want?
My back salary for the past 4 months. $6.12.
You can't do that to me. Any of you. I'll go to the courts. I'll get lawyers.
Why, Horace Van Degelder, if you aren't handsome in that outfit, so few men these days have the courage to wear pinstripes and plaid.
Dolly Gallagher.
I know what you're going to say. You're unsatisfied with Ernestina. Well, I have another girl for you. The ideal wife. But don't let me interrupt you. You were doing something. What were you doing?
Getting Cornelius's money, Dolly. $146.
And 35 cents.
Plus the $6.12 of mine.
And the money my mama left me. $52.48.
38.
48.
All right, all right. If it's money you want, the safe is upstairs.
All right, let's go.
Come on, we're getting our money we have all day.
We can go see the whale.
You can see those.
Yes.
You can open
twice.
Money, 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 money. Mr. Van Degelder's money. It's like the sun we walk under. It can kill or cure. Mr. Van Degelder's never tired of saying that most people in the world are fools. And in a way, he's right, isn't he? Himself, Irene, Cornelius, myself. Yes, we're all fools and we're all in danger of destroying the world in our folly. But the surest way to keep us out of harm is a little money. The difference between a little money and no money is enormous and can shatter the world. And the difference between a little money and an enormous amount of money is very slight. And that can shatter the world too. It's all in how you use it. As my late husband Ephraim Levi used to say, money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It's not worth a thing unless it's spread around encouraging young things to grow. Anyway, that's the opinion of the second Mrs. Van Degelder, which reminds me, Ephraim, I'm ready for that sign.
Mr. Van Degelder?
Well, don't just stand there. That goes upstairs.
Well, as I was saying, I found you the ideal wife.
Dolly Gallagher, I don't want you to find me the ideal wives. If I want an ideal wife, I'll find one on my own. And I found her. And it's you, damn it.
Why, Horace?
Dolly, I know I've been a fool about Mrs. Malloy and that other woman. But, Dolly, forgive me. Marry me.
Horace, stop right there.
What do you mean?
You and I both know that you're the first citizen of Yonkers, and your wife would have to be a somebody. Answer me. Am I somebody?
You are. Wonderful woman.
Oh, you're partial. It won't be enough to shower your wife with money and jewels to insist she be a benefactress of half the town. By the way, it's bad business letting Cornelius open shop right across the street from yours. Better take him in and let him be your partner.
Partner?
And Barnaby can have Cornelius's old job.
Now see here, Dolly.
That way we can all dance at Ermengar's wedding.
That does it. You've gone too far. I'll dance at no wedding. Besides, I don't know how, and it would take me weeks, months, years to learn. All right, I'll dance.
Why, Horace, I never thought you'd say a thing like that.
That front room, idiot. Well, go on. What are you waiting for?
What is going on up there?
Nothing. I just thought I'd have that front room done over in blue wallpaper.
Horace.
I know the old paper ain't worn out yet, but that fella's just set up in business and needs a good start. You see, Dolly, I've always felt that money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It's not worth a thing unless...
Thank you, Ephraim.
Hello, Dolly. Well, hello, Dolly. It's so nice to have you here where you belong.
I never knew, Dolly, without you, Dolly. Life was softly flat, and more than that was awfully wrong.
My hat, Horace, I'm staying where I'm at, Horace. Dolly, you'll never go away.
Wonderful woman.
Again.